May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
And joined in God's mission for the life of the world. grace and love of God, do you desire to have your child baptized into Christ? As you bring your child to receive the gift of baptism, you are entrusted with responsibilities to live with him among God's faithful people, bring him to the Word of God and the Holy Supper, teach him the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments, place in his hands the Holy Scriptures, and nurture him in faith and prayer, so that he may learn to trust God, proclaim Christ through word and deed, care for others and the world God made, and work for justice and peace. Do you promise to help Wesley grow in the Christian faith and life? Sponsors, do you promise to nurture Wesley in the Christian faith as you are empowered by God's Spirit and to help him live in the covenant of baptism and in the communion with the church? People of God, do you promise to support Wesley and pray for him in his new life in Christ?
We do.
I invite the congregation to stand as we confess our faith. I ask you to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, reject sin, and confess the faith of the church. Do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God? Do you renounce the powers of this world that rebel against God? Do you renounce the ways of sin that draw you from God? Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion of saints,
the forgiveness of sins,
the resurrection of the body,
and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Forever. Amen. the newly baptized. And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please take a moment to share God's peace with one another and welcome our newest member.
Crown them.
You have made them rule of the works of your hands.
flocks and cattle, even the wild beasts of the field.
The birds of the air, the fish of the sea, and whatever passes along the paths of the sea.
O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
God's goofy math. And I think if we can get the lights on to number two. That might help us to dim the lights slightly. The ushers are working on it. They'll take care of it. Anyway, you can't see this up here. It says 1 plus 1 plus 1 equals 1. Now, Cora and Grant, don't tell Wesley this, because in school, 1 plus 1 plus 1 is 3. But here in church, the theologians tell us that the Trinity, three persons of God, is one. The one God in three forms, or in three persons. I'm always asking, well, where is the Trinity to be found in the Bible? And my answer is always nowhere and everywhere. That is, there isn't a specific page or book dedicated to the teaching of God as a triune God. But if you listen to the authors of Scripture, you see that they experience God in different ways, in different forms, in different persons, and therefore the church realized that this was an important teaching to think of God in three persons. So imagine we were to go through our Bibles, and if you brought them today, you should bring them out or find them in the pew rack or find your bulletin for our Bring Your Bible to Church series. If we were to highlight our Bibles so that every time we saw God the Father, we did one color, and Jesus the Son another color, and the Holy Spirit a third color, we might have scriptures that would look like this. Now, here, this is one of the most familiar scriptures that refers to God's triune name. It's at the end of Matthew's Gospel, chapter 28, when Jesus gives the Great Commission, and he says to his friends this, and let's read it together if you can see it.
Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
And what a joy to have a baptism this morning to reinforce this teaching of God's triune name. There's another example that we could pull from Scripture at the end of one of Paul's letters to the Corinthians. This will sound familiar to you as well. Let's read it together if you can see it.
The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the union of the Holy Spirit be with all of you.
So there is a few of the most common verses. Now, if we were to look at today's reading from Romans, which I'll preach on, and if we were to highlight the three different persons or forms of the Trinity, it would look like this. You can see all three are mentioned in just these short five verses. Now, just a side note that God as Trinity is a mystery. And, you know, some people with mysteries just throw up their hands and say, I give up. But the church has always said, well, yes, God is a mystery. We can't fully understand God. But that doesn't mean that God doesn't want to be knowable and approachable. And so for generations, people of faith have continued to try and approach God as three and one and three through these different metaphors. One of them, of course, is the clover or the shamrock. St. Patrick used this many years ago to try and share three different leaves on one stem, one God, three persons. A more modern example from science would remind us that water takes the form of H2O, and it can be a liquid, it can be a solid as ice, or it can be a gas. Evaporating or steam. The metaphor that I prefer is to take a banana and split it into three equal parts. If you've never done that, you might want to look it up on YouTube, see how you do that. The best part about this metaphor is you get to eat it when you're done teaching about it. But maybe the most helpful way to think of God as Trinity is through relationships. And so here we have a family photo of some women in a family, and you have a grandma, and she has her two daughters here. So if you were to think of this woman over here, she is a daughter, she is a sister, and she is an aunt. Same person, three different relationships. Daughter, sister, aunt. And that's helpful for me to think of God as one who relates to us in different ways. Same God, by God as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Or maybe these names that help describe the function of each of the three persons of the Trinity are helpful as well. God as Creator, God as Savior or Redeemer, and God as Sanctifier or Sustainer or Comforter or God. We could use a lot of different words to describe the work of the Holy Spirit. So let's take a look at our text for today. It's not a specific teaching on the Trinity, but it does, I think, reveal the power of the Triune God at work in the world. So find your bulletin or your Bible, and you might want to mark what's important to you or underline what you think is important as we hear this text speaking to us. It starts out by saying, therefore, since we are justified by faith. Well, we have to know that Paul is writing, and who's the we that he's talking about? Well, the people he's written this letter to. Now, the context of Paul as an evangelist or a writer, you have to remember that he traveled a lot, and he started churches here in Greece, here in Turkey. He spent a lot of time traveling around the Mediterranean Sea. He did make it over to Rome once over here. The letter that we have today is to the Romans before he had ever visited there. Seeing this graphic just reminds me. I mean, there was Paul, a couple thousand years ago, sailing across the Mediterranean Sea, where, of course, there is sadly so much focus in our day with the tragedy that has happened over the years. And just reminds me of how faith becomes so real and speaks so powerfully to us in our day and age. So in Paul's context, he was trying to share the good news of Jesus as Lord and Savior with as many people as he could, and he visited and he wrote letters in order to do that. Now, a few weeks ago, we learned that Paul probably really didn't write the letters. A scribe, a professional writer, probably wrote them as he dictated them to him. So here's an artist's rendition of Paul sharing a letter, maybe that was Ephesians or Galatians or maybe it's Romans. If we think of the context of Paul trying to share the good news, we know that this letter of the Romans that we're looking at today was written in the mid-50s, not the doo-wop era of the 50s, but the original, first century common era of the 50s, sometime between 54 and 58. So that's pretty recent after things with Jesus have come to a culmination, and he's trying to continue that good word. Jesus. It's his longest work, it's his most significant work, and it's also been called by biblical scholars as Paul's most influential work. And he's trying to share the universal message of grace to both Jew and Gentile. He's trying to reach all people. So let's take a look at this verse by verse. So verse 1 says, therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace. So first we note here in the Lutheran Christian Church, this phrase, justified by faith, is one we're familiar with because of the Reformers kind of anchoring on to this as a phrase that has remained important to us to this day. So what do those who claim to be justified by faith have? Well, we have peace. We have peace. And didn't choir just beautifully deliver that message? It's a gift for Christians to have a gift of peace. We might not always receive it because we're so busy, we're so 24 connected, but we are granted this gift of peace. Verse 2. Through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. We stand together in God's grace. That's what enables us to stand. Divided, we fall, but united in God's grace, we stand. And each Sunday, we start our services on our knees, or sitting, confessing our need for God's wholeness in our lives. But having heard that, we stand together and celebrate God's goodness. Verse 3. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance. So if we pause here, we have to go back and notice that something has been repeated. In verse 2, the word boast, and verse 3, the word boast, have been repeated. And when something's repeated, we pay attention to it. So you might want to circle those or underline those. Paul uses the word boast 8 times in the letter to Romans. So what is he trying to get across here? Well, he's saying that we should boast in 2 things here. We should boast in the hope of sharing the glory of God, and we should boast in our sufferings. More on that in just a minute. Now, we know that in Scripture, both the same word is used many times, 72 times, Old Testament and New Testament. Let's look at a few examples in the Old Testament. This is ground out what Paul is sharing here in the New Testament. Psalm 34:2 says, "My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad." And Jeremiah shares in 9:24, "Let those who boast, boast in this, that they understand and know me, that I am the Lord. I act with steadfast love, justice, and righteousness in the earth. For in these things I delight, says the Lord." So this word boast is important for us in Romans. What is he getting at? Now we need to know that in Paul's time, people would boast of many things, maybe some of the same things we boast of. But one thing in particular that Paul was wanting to address was those who were boasting in following the law, in strict adherence to the law. Those who might say, "Well, I was born of the Jewish, of the chosen race. We have, you know, this gift from God, Moses, that's been given to us, and we continue to follow it." And Paul, not trying to downplay that, says, "Well, that's not the occasion to put yourself above others. Because the grace of God in which we stand brings us all as a united people. So don't boast in that," he says, "but rather boast in sharing the glory of God as equals, and boast in our sufferings and hardships." We'll get to that. So this idea of boasting is important. So it made me think, well, what do people boast about in our day? And there are many things that people might boast about, whether they have the fanciest clothes to wear, or whether or not they have the fastest car to drive, or whether or not they have the smallest microchip in their handheld device. And we can fill in the blank with what you hear people boasting about, or what you might be tempted to boast about. But what a contrast to know that, according to Paul, God's people are to boast in the hope of sharing God's glory and in our sufferings. Now, the first part of that, I think we do quite well. Think about it and maybe desire to share in God's glory, in God's goodness, in God's abundance. That second part, boasting in our sufferings, might cause us to pause for a second. So let's spend a second there. And in order to look at this, we need to look at these three verses together, this run-on sentence that Paul has. And Paul is very good at run-on sentences. And not only that, it says, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance. And endurance produces character. And character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. Now, this word sufferings can also be translated as hardships, trials, tribulations. Again, we need to think of Paul and his context as he's writing this. What were some of the things that the early church was experiencing as suffering, hardships, tribulations, and trials? Well, here's an image of Paul in prison. You know that at some point in his preaching career, he was arrested and taken into prison. And we know from the writings of the early church witnesses that many of the followers of Jesus were persecuted and ridiculed and tormented. And so this helps understand what Paul might be talking about as far as sufferings and hardships, trials and tribulations of those. But he lifts up that there's a way for us who are faithful to view those hardships. And that is something that leads us to a fuller understanding of God's power. For hardships, he says, produce endurance, endurance produces character, character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us. We need to reflect just for a second. Our world is full of hardships, is it not? Full of sufferings, far too many of them. Whether it's Christians in Syria being wiped out or fleeing for their lives, or terrorism continuing to disturb and ruin people's lives, or Zika virus so close to our homeland, causing such harm, or so much more that each of us could add as far as personal hardships that we have known or our loved ones are facing. I like what a Mennonite professor said about this text and hardships. He said, in response to all these hardships, some people choose to paint an optimistic face on the world, seeking to push through the day's burdens almost oblivious to the painful realities around us. And yet others all but lose hope in any kind of better future. But this reading, he says, this reading from Romans helps us navigate an alternate path, affirming that a life of faith and hope grounded in the creative and redeeming work of the Triune God is capable of confronting difficulties of our journeys. He continues, saying, such faith and hope encourage awareness and activism. Activism like yesterday's community service day. They also teach us when to let go, trusting that ultimately this is God's work. God's work in us, we believe, is to, through hardships, bring endurance. Endurance that builds character, character that produces hope. For we believe God wants us to live in hope. And at the very center and the main point of this message that I believe becomes this portion of the verse, God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Here is the center of gravity for those who believe that all is not lost in the world. Yes, we embrace the hardships of our lives. Yes, we acknowledge the reality of the world around us, but we do not lose hope, for we believe that our inner nature, as Paul says, is being renewed day by day. An inner nature that we believe is experienced by God pouring into us when we pour out water, as we just did, into a font, proclaiming God's goodness to wash over one person's life, and all those who are washed in God's grace. And so too, we believe that when bread is broken and wine is poured, that very Spirit is entering into your life to strengthen you to face the day ahead. Maybe you remember the old Gatorade commercial that showed the silhouette of an athlete who had been exercising and was depleted of hydration and vital nutrients, and when the Gatorade is gulped down, the body fills with good things. I want you to think of this Romans verse this coming week. Every time you pour something, like cream into your coffee, or cereal into a bowl, or maybe you have pets and you're filling up their water bowls, you're pouring out. So too, God has poured into you the Holy Spirit of his love. And God continues to pour into the church day by day, moment by moment, pouring into us a spirit of confidence and courage, a spirit of generosity and gentleness, a spirit of compassion and calm. So the invitation this morning is clear. Let this creator, redeemer, and sustainer of a God pour into you all that is necessary so that the hardships of this life will not wear you down, but rather fill you up. And now to him who is able to accomplish abundantly beyond all we ask or imagine, to him be glory, now and forever.
Thank you.
I need to share, and that is today is the last day of Sunday school. We are eternally grateful to our teachers and volunteers that help support that ministry of passing on the faith to the new generation. I know many of you who are actually here are going to have you stand and be recognized. You can just wave your hand if you're a Sunday school teacher or helper. We're so grateful for your faithfulness.
Our Lord, who taught us
Calvary's disciples, we will give glory to God
and share Christ's love.
Now the Lord bless you and keep you. Let his face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.